In Belfast, the British Army is once again back in the old routine. Men in the middle, keeping peace between two warring factions. But this time, it's not Aden, Cyprus, or some far-off colony. It is, incredibly, in Britain's own backyard, Northern Ireland.
But a lot have come down. See, this peace line goes along Falls Road. It goes roughly along to Cooper Street. You know where Cooper Street is? Around Cooper Street, and then on to Springfield Road.
For 5 weeks, the army has been in Belfast, whose centre now looks like some awful British version of Berlin. 7,500 British troops have been sent to Northern Ireland, the largest number of any peacekeeping operation since Indian independence in 1947. It is a lunatic but sad fact that but for the British Army, there would be civil war between Catholic and Protestant in this part of Britain. In spite of all the inquiries, promised reforms and appeals to moderation, the truth is that the extremists on both sides make the running and want victory, not a settlement. Belfast has gradually got used to army patrols on its streets and army checkpoints. Perhaps Belfast is getting a little too used to the sight of soldiers and guns. It seems like a bad dream, but for 5 weeks, Belfast has been a city full of barricades, barbed wire, and soldiers. Major Chichester Clark realized that only the British Army could bring the city and country back to sanity. The setting up of an army peace line was easier said than done. The army tactics were to play it cool, to talk their plan onto the locals, not force it. In some places, the discussions were every bit as tortuous as the Vietnam peace talks. The deal was that barricades would come down and army wire barriers would go up at the same time. But the barrier for keeping Belfast Christians from attacking each other soon ran into snags in places. The locals provided tea, but also plenty of objections. The army hesitated.
It's really being a bit of a problem for you at the moment, isn't it? I mean, you don't seem to have any very strict instructions to go ahead, or I mean, you're just holding back.
No, it's not true. We are working on this so-called peace line further up behind us, at exact locations. We know exactly what we're doing. The reason we were here is that yesterday they asked us to take this down, regardless of the peace line, to take it down. This morning they've changed their minds.
The army peace line zigzags between the troubled centre of Belfast, the Protestant Shankill Road, and the Catholic Falls Road area. It is now complete except in one place, Dover Street, the shortest direct route between the Protestant and Catholic strongholds, and the scene of August's fighting. At first, the army moved in to build their peace line on the site of the Protestant barricade. Work proceeded smoothly. But soon, there were Protestant protests. If the peace line were built on their barricade, some Protestants would be stranded in a Catholic area. Work stopped while the army checked with headquarters. General Freeland, commander of the British troops, arrived to inspect the line. The line had been agreed the previous day between Protestants and Catholics at Belfast City Hall. The army had no say in its placing.
We've had a hold up for some reason, they've just seen about it now.
Hey, he wants to.
But soon, General Freeland was to face what his troops have been facing these past 5 weeks.
I see, he's going to fix up something. Yes, what's it, materials or,
no, sir,
or exactly where to put it?
Exactly where to put it, I think, sir.
Can I speak? Can I speak?
Of course you can, everybody.
Well,
speaks.
We live in Beverly Street.
Oh, yeah.
This is Beverly Street down here. What's that putting a barrier here for?
And that street down Aden.
And us land, yes.
We should be down the street.
I think we better leave it to whoever's arranging it.
Yeah, well, wait
to
see about it.
Wait to City Hall to see about it.
Oh, have they? They've gone there.
Yeah,
oh, yeah. That's
right.
We want to try and get everybody to agree where to put it.
Yes, but this was arranged in the City Hall, sir, yeah. Where the barrier was going.
Was it?
Between the councillors.
Well, they're the people who've got to say where to put it, because we don't know.
Yes, they have already said where to put it, and that is the wrong place.
I see.
And I have tried to tell them
all the
morning.
Oh, I see. Well, they probably don't quite know. We'll sort it out. Don't worry, we'll
go further down.
This was only the beginning of the continuing story of the Dover Street peace line. Dover Street is not typical of Belfast, but then neither were the mobs who came along it in August and brought Northern Ireland near to civil war. Even General Freeland's diplomacy cannot quiet the bitterness when Catholic meets Protestant in this street.
We keep these out and we keep up there.
That's just fair enough. I don't want nothing to do with
it. We have lived for about a past month with this fear too.
Well, what fear? What about us? Of our people?
Yes.
Are you choking me?
We aren't the Armstrongs that we have brought out to be.
But you're not the Armstrongs.
You have accused of being Armstrongs.
How many is? Have I wasn't working?
I don't care.
The troops had to move quickly to prevent the Catholic crowds massing. In Dover Street, Catholics and Protestants jealously guard their own territory to the last inch. And now that the army peace line was in dispute, the Protestants began to gather at their end of the street to fight it out. The trouble was over house number 87, a Catholic home. The Protestants wanted the peace line below it. The Catholics wanted the line above it to include it in Catholic territory. It was all a tragic replay of Irish history. In 1921, a British Army machine gun post was outside the same house to prevent Catholics and Protestants from murdering each other. Now, once again, it was on the front line of religious hatred and bigotry. On the Protestant side, a local councillor protested to the army captain that just because one Catholic house was there, that could not mean the Protestants would not claim the territory.
All over the city, and it will be impossible for you to apply this principle. I am talking about yesterday morning, I agreed a length with my opposite number Republican representatives. It was agreed and settled. We all went out, and there was a definite line on a map. All night, and I've been at it all morning, trying to get the line agreed. After all this, now we are happy with this, perfectly happy with this as it is at the moment. All I'm saying is that if you wish to apply the principle of because this lady lives in here for 50 years, that we now must push this barricade back, it will be impossible for you to apply it throughout this city.
But what difference is 20 feet going to make?
The difference is, which I tried to explain to you earlier, that on Sunday, you fellas had to tear gas our people. Why? Because an incident started whereby Republicans marched tricolour into Percy Street. And the closer they get to our people, the more trouble you're going to have controlling both crowds.
The army captain then went to the Catholics to suggest a compromise. But compromise is a rare thing in Dover Street these days.
Your mother should go to number 87.
Right.
Okay?
Free access.
And have free access to it.
Yes.
Will you now agree if we make... You see the corner where your grandmother is?
Yeah.
We will make a one-man corridor or one-woman corridor to your mother's house.
Yeah.
Connecting with the barrier where it is now against 89.
No.
Can I speak to this man?
Before you go any further,
Before you go,
we are the committee representing this district. And wait a wee minute. There's too much concession that's been given to one side. We have already suffered enough down in this district and we're given no more concessions. If you want to put your barrier up, put it at Babley Street. This man here knows what we have suffered.
That's a Catholic
and we are suffering no more.
Catholic houses in the Catholic quarter, Protestant houses in the Protestant quarter, and
that's
we'll
all
be
we
happy.
Ask.
There's where the Catholic houses start. Put the barricade across there. Will you tell them that up until last night the barricade was across from Beverly Street? What's the idea of moving it down all of a sudden when it's becoming permanent?
I've just asked, sir, that I may be allowed to negotiate. Please allow me to negotiate and go back where you have just come from. Will you please now take you as a senior citizen here? Thank you very much.
It was to no avail. The army can keep the two sides apart, but not bring them together. At the end of the day, the army engineers took their peace line and departed. Nothing was to be done without the agreement of local inhabitants. Nothing was to be forced on the two sides. The army was neutral and helpless. There is still no finished peace line at Dover Street. Catholics and Protestants are as far apart as ever. It is true that the rest of the line is completed, but the Protestants in Dover Street decided to build a barricade of their own in protest against the peace line and to fence them off from the Catholics at the other end of the street. The corner house, number 87, is not even occupied. The old Catholic lady who lives there has gone away. But it stands as a miserable monument to Northern Ireland's hate. The edginess of Belfast and the delicate position of a British military occupation of a British city was illustrated this weekend by the deaths of two British soldiers. Both of them were declared accidents. One of them, craftsman Christopher Edgar, was shot while on perimeter patrol at a guards company headquarters. On Sunday, the army said they were treating it as a case of murder. Investigations went on with the press outside the fence all morning. Later, the Ulster police said no foul play was suspected. But there were plenty of doubts in Belfast, even among soldiers, as to what really happened. Army commanders know that if British soldiers become a target for extremists, the security situation could become explosive. But the weekend also brought some hope as Protestant barricades in the city began to come down. They were originally put up not so much for protection against Catholic invasion, but as a tit for tat, a counter to hundreds of Catholic barricades built after the August fighting. While the barricades were up, the children enjoyed them, and they sadly reinforced all the old divisions, all the old militant songs and feelings. As the Protestant barricades came down, the army this week prepared to act against the barricaded Free Belfast area, the Catholic heartland. Again, the problem was diplomatic, not military. After Catholic leaders had agreed in principle that their barricades should come down, the army showed up in force on Tuesday morning to oversee their dismantling. After much bitter argument, the Defence Committee and the people at the barricades agreed.
Why didn't they return the fire?
I don't know, I wasn't there. Were you?
Why did it happen here?
We are informed by the defense committee over there. We are fully informed.
These are known.
Excuse me a moment, what is that?
But, sir, they're still attacking the districts, they're still attacking the Catholic districts.
Yes, I'm not here to discuss your politics. You have your own representatives, and they're very good, and they're doing their job. They're the people to talk to.
Father Patrick Murphy, with General Dybal, toured Free Belfast to convince the militants that if the barricades went down, the army would be around to protect them. Once again, it was jaw, not war, that the army had to face. And some soldiers were frankly fed up with the delays.
The barricades were to be negotiated, you see, but the main reason being for the barricades to be negotiated were that some of them were facing sniper's fire. And now, the one down there, and this one at the very top, were the ones that were facing the sniper's fire. And they were to be negotiated to be not necessarily to be taken down. Well, we didn't get that privilege of even speaking to you.
Somebody has decided they can come down. Not up to me. I'm here to see if it goes down fairly and squarely, okay, without trouble.
But the army's waiting game finally paid off. The Catholic barricades of Free Belfast, the last big ones in the city, began to come down yesterday. The kid glove technique had worked. Now, the army has the bigger job of guarding a Belfast without barricades, a city which the army has to watch day and night for outbreaks of trouble. Then, as I was coming down our left, A Company headquarters, the 3rd Light Infantry.
Right. And I looked across and put the searchlight on there, and there was a man and two women over there, absolutely petrified, and they said they'd been shot at. 3 shots was reported from them. In fact, my section down here reported 2 shots and then another further 3 shots. And I would say from the trajectory of both those lot that they are coming from somewhere in this area.
I presume
here.
It's someone in Butler Street. Banging away in that direction to try and stir it.
They certainly weren't aim shots, though, so I would say it's purely somebody trying to, you know, raise their whole attention.
But does that make sense? Is that the sort of thing they might do, shoot away from there just to stir it?
Chatham Street, I
Chatham,
think.
Chatham, yes. Chatham.
Shot
Chatham.
Well.
Wait. Whereabouts was this shot at, over?
Another one.
Hooker Street. All right, move it. Hello, 3-3, this is 3 shots, Hooker Street area, wait out, over. Hello, Zaria, this is 3, acknowledge, over.
Yeah, roger that.
Isolated shooting incidents like this have to be dealt with every night in the 3rd Light Infantry area.
Were you actually parked here when it happened? Because we hear it was a blue 1100 that came round the corner, they parked on the corner here, fired about 5 shots up and then went straight behind.
That's it. Now, what I want you to do is to search for any empty cases at all. Use the gun as in these side lanes that's gone.
But in a city as big as Belfast, troublemakers are hard to find. A few shots can easily stir up trouble nightly. Colonel John Ballenden, commanding the 3rd Light Infantry, believes many of the incidents he investigates are trivial, but become exaggerated by rumour.
Do you find that the incidents bear this out?
They do. We have one, we splendid one of this. Major Hitchcock, myself, heard a Volkswagen backfire once, and within 15 minutes, that was 6 rounds of definite rifle fire fired from the Volkswagen. Tonight, I'm going to be torn off in about half an hour ago. Heaven really knows what that was. It could have been anything. It could have been a car backfiring. It could have been someone deliberately stirring things to get more protection. It could have been absolutely anything. You just don't know how people's minds work when they are frightened.
What I think does happen, though, Colonel, is everyone who hears a shot takes it so personally that they think that shot is really meant for them.
Yep.
Or they certainly do this on both sides.
Mm. We just finished a 10-month stint in Mauritius. Much the same thing. 2 rival religious factions, the Christians and the Muslims. The pattern, almost the same. And you were in Aden. I don't know how that compares.
Well, the Aden, I think, was slightly different in that you didn't have the 2 clear-cut factions, one on each side. You had NLF on Flossie at each other's throats, and you couldn't tell the difference between the 2. Very similar to that here. You cannot tell the difference between Protestants and Catholics until you can get them apart and drive a wedge in between them, if you've got 2 mobs together, that is.
It is quite ridiculous. You meet a clergyman and you say to him, do I call you Reverend or do I call you Father? And it is as ridiculous as that. One has no idea. You find a crowd on the corner. The first thing to do is to grab a sensible man and say, are they Catholics or Protestants? And then sort of deal with them in the appropriate manner.
Colonel, this situation's been going on for quite a long time now. The last 3 or 4 weeks, barricades have been out there only just starting to come down, which really seems to put the situation back to square one without solving anything very much. Do you think the tension is easing in the city?
Superficially, it certainly is. Whether it really is deep down underneath, I don't honestly know. And Keith's had this example today in the last 24 hours of school children.
It's been quite appalling, to see it happen. The last 3 days it's built up into, yesterday was the worst day we've had of school children from 5 schools, 3 of them Catholic, 3 of them Protestant, coming home, down the crumbling rain from school. And little children, 6 years old, are apparently taught the hate and the bitterness that their parents have. And this builds up on both sides of the road, and you get children being beaten and hit and stoned coming home from school. Even some of them with their little rubber catapults shooting staples at each other. The parents are as much to blame, you know, as the children are.
The people are confident. This is sort of grassroots level. The people are confident while there are soldiers about or in the areas where the IUC go, where the IUC are about. They are worried, I think, about what the long-term solution is going to be.
In Northern Ireland, the moderates are always being asked to stand up and be counted by all of us. But until that day arrives, the army will remain the only effective force for moderation. The men in the middle, between Catholics and Protestants.